In the name of Allah, may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon His final messenger, Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his companions, and all those who follow him until the day of judgment. Before commencing, we are, alhamdulillah, doing the 40 hadith of Imam al-Nawawi. And as in the introduction, we mentioned that in the introduction of Imam al-Nawawi himself, we mentioned that you wrote the hadith in the second bookshelf on the top. No? It's not there? Maybe I left it at home. It's okay. Madratan, sorry. It's okay, Madratan. So we'll go through it this time. Next time I'll bring them and leave them here. So we mentioned in the introduction that Imam al-Nawawi mentions that there are several hadith about the virtues of reading 40 hadith. And then he mentions that there are several scholars that wrote 40 hadith. 40 hadith of different things, right? So inshallah, come closer, so that we can get the barakah together as the angels. We can let the angels come around us. Let us not come around the angels, inshallah. Right, so let us come closer. Okay, so I brought some examples just to give you an idea. And inshallah, in the future, we'll go through it, right? So I brought some, when I went to Norway, in one of the stalls, they had Arba'inat. They have 40 hadith. So there's a series called Arba'in, Al-Arba'in. So this is the Arba'in of Shawali al-Dahlawi. Right? This Arba'in of Shawali al-Dahlawi, it is related, it has a chain that goes from his teacher, Abu Tahir al-Madani, all the way to Imam al-Husayn. This is what makes this Arba'in unique. 40 hadith that Shawali al-Dahlawi heard from his teacher all the way to Imam al-Husayn, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the grandson of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is number one. Number two, this is Arba'in of Jalaluddin al-Suyuti. Shawali al-Dahlawi from Delhi. Jalaluddin al-Suyuti from Egypt. He wrote this 40 hadith on rulings, fada'il, and zuhud, right? Abstinence from the dunya. And then this is Al-Arba'in of Mula Ali Qari. Al-Arba'in of Mula Ali Qari, he wrote on the Ijaz, on the wisdom and the preciseness of Rasulullah in saying words. Like with a few words gives you a lot of meaning. Because Ijaz fil kalam. Right? So this is all about that. Then you have this Arba'in, again of Mula Ali Qari, on Fada'il al-Qur'an, the virtues of the Qur'an. So alhamdulillah, I have Ijaz in this book as well. So bi'idhnillah, we'll study it. So alhamdulillah, so I got it from my shaykh, and it goes to Mula Ali Qari all the way to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then we have another Arba'in about the Fada'il Ahlul Bayt, the virtues, hadith, that talk about the virtues of Ahlul Bayt, the family of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then we have another Arba'in by Ibn al-Asakir. This Arba'in of Ibn al-Asakir is al-Dimashqi. So you have Delhi, Masri, Dimashqi, right? So you have many, this is Islam. So this Arba'in of Ibn al-Asakir has, for every hadith, has the chain. So this is like an advanced course. When we read one hadith, we'll go through the name so that you can get an idea of how it is to study the hadith. So this Arba'in, what is it about? This Arba'in is specifically only about Ummahat al-Mu'mineen, the mothers of the believers. 40 hadith about the mothers of the believers. So we have a little bit of work to do. Yeah. Right? A little bit of work to do. But we want to really engage in this garden of studying the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So last week we did hadith number 4. And the hadith number 4 was on Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, right? Radiallahu ta'ala anhu. We're not going to get into the summary or of last hadith. Today we're in hadith number 5. So we're doing a different approach. This approach is number 1. If the narrator wasn't introduced, we're going to introduce the narrator, number 1. And number 2, we're going to go through the hadith. So hadith number, the narrator for hadith number 5. Umm al-Mu'mineen, mother of the believers. Umm Abdullah, mother of Abdullah, Aisha, bint Abi Bakr, radiallahu ta'ala anha, as-siddiqa, known as the truthful, bint as-siddiq, the daughter of the truthful.
Why you say mother of Abdullah?
That's a nickname. So for example, like the daughter of the Prophet, one of them was named Kulthum before she got married. Abu Huraira was named the father of the cat. He didn't have a baby named Cat, right? But that was the name that the Prophet gave him. So here, this is Abdullah, the mother of Abdullah, right? So this is, yeah, this is a very good question, very good question.
You have a son like Abdullah?
No. Yeah, because the Prophet ﷺ died before, right? So this is, okay, so her name, her surname was given as it was given to the other Mahat. Right, other ummahat al-mu'minin from the Quran. Allah calls them ummahat al-mu'minin. Right, after Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha was, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha was the first, the only one, right, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha was the only one to be married to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam without being married before. Alright, the other wives were widows, were Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha was widowed twice, etc., etc. MashaAllah. Assalamu alaikum, Brother Saeed. Brother Saeed is watching from Kashmir. Hafidahullah. May Allah bless you all and inshallah restore the condition of Kashmir, inshallah. Allahumma ameen. So, she was the most beloved to Rasulullah after the death of Khadija. The Prophet ﷺ was asked by a Sahabi, Ya Rasulullah, who is the most beloved? He said, Aisha, radiallahu ta'ala anha. Wa min al-rijal, to see their wives, and from the men, Abuha, her father. Right? Right? So they're trying to say, Ya Rasulullah, anta, you know, that the Prophet is going to say, you are the most beloved to me. But he said, who is the, imagine, like if somebody asks you, another man asks you, who is the most beloved to you? Sometimes you feel ashamed to say your wife. Right? The Prophet ﷺ, our teacher, he was asked, who is the most beloved? He said, Aisha, my wife. And then, her father. Look at the relationship he had with his father-in-law. Right? Look at that love. Right, that's very important as well. She was the only one of the wives of the Prophet ﷺ. She was the most knowledgeable. She in fiqh amongst them. She was a zahida. Right? She loved Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the hereafter and was sacrificed for that. She was generous. She was eloquent. She was eloquent. And she used to frequently fast. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam advised. He said, take half of the deen from Aisha. Take half of the deen from Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, a sahabi radiallahu ta'ala anha, said, no hadith ever showed us difficulty except that we went to Aisha and she knew the explanation for it. So men, Sahabis, used to go to Aisha with the proper guidelines, right? They used to go to her to seek knowledge. Az-Zuhri, man kana Az-Zuhri? Who was Az-Zuhri? Az-Zuhri was one of the teachers of Imam Abu Hanifa. Okay? So we mentioned last time that there was a golden chain. Right? The golden chain was Abu Hanifa, his teacher, Nafi', the slave of Abdullah ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Umar, Rasulullah. This is considered the golden chain in the Sanad. There is another chain which includes Az-Zuhri. So it's Abu Hanifa, Az-Zuhri, and Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So this is from where Abu Hanifa got his knowledge. from Az-Zuhri, right? From Az-Zuhri to Anas ibn Malik. Abu Hanifa radiallahu ta'ala who got his knowledge from Nafi' to Abdullah ibn Umar. Right? So it's to know that there is a particular sanad, a chain of where Imam Al-Akbar, right, Abu Hanifa rahimahullah got his knowledge from. Az-Zuhri said, if knowledge of Aisha was gathered, and the knowledge of all of the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the women of the world, all of their knowledge was gathered together, Aisha's knowledge would surpass it, would be greater. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala collected 2,210 hadith that are from her. She died at the age of 60 and was buried in Jannatul Baqi. So this is just an introduction, and there's a lot more that can be said about Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. So this fifth hadith on authority of al-Mu'mineen, Abdullah, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha said that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qal, man ahdata fi amrina hadha ma laysa minhu fahuwa raddun. وفي رواية من عمل عملا ليس عليه أمرنا فهو رد. The definition is whoever introduces into our affairs of Islam, into our affairs, that which is not of it, then it is rejected. In another riwayah, whoever does an action of from an action that is not from our actions, then it is rejected. What does this mean? When the Prophet ﷺ said, the first part, whoever introduces into this affairs that which is not of ours, it is rejected. This hadith teaches us, before we get into the explanation, the significance and importance of knowledge of fiqh, of understanding of fiqh, from a holistic point of view. So this is an indication that acts of worship, and what are the parts of fiqh? Fiqh al-ibadat and fiqh of al-mu'amalat, right? And in the mu'amalat, you have al-uqud, contracts, al-jinaya, crimes, al-hudud, prescribed punishment for those crimes, al-zawaj, al-talaq, right? And all of these different subjects. These are in the mu'amalat. Okay? So in the explanation, Imam An-Nawawi said that this is an indication that acts of worship, like ghusl, because ghusl, wudu, salah, sawm, fasting, they all have a prescribed methodology, a kayfiyah, a how-to, right? So if you add anything to that kayfiyah, that how-to, then it is rejected. Okay? So some restrain this that fiqh is only ibadat, only worship. La. Imam An-Nawawi said this also includes contracts, transactions. Alright? So if the contract is corrupt, then Islamically that contract is rejected from a spiritual level. So that means that if the contract is rejected from a spiritual level, that halal money that's earned and brought to the family is not as halal as you think it is. See how serious this is? See how serious? If the contract is rejected, then that which comes with it is also rejected. Okay? Now, there's an example, and this is the conclusion. It's very brief, but it's very deep. The example is that the Prophet ﷺ said to a man, came to him and said, my son was an employee to this one, to this person. And my son committed zina, fornicated with his wife. The father said, so now the father is recognizing that his son committed that sin. Right? وَنَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ ذَلِكَ. And he, so the father's coming saying, my son did this. And I have been told that my son should have a particular punishment within a government, and where there is a whole system, like in an Islamic law, when there is a system, because the law, this is very important, even if this crime is committed, if there's not a system and a law, and there is chaos, the law cannot be taken into one's own hands. It has to be investigated, it has to be a qadi, a law, and then the judge will prescribe with all the evidence and all the case, the due punishment. So this is not like here in the West, that this happens so rapidly always, that we're gonna start implementing this law. This is just for to learn about Islamic law. But in the West, if that, now that's still a crime, it doesn't mean that it's not a sin and that it's not a crime with Allah. But whatever is not paid in this dunya is paid in the hereafter. So don't worry, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take care of it. Right? So now look at this. The hadith was, whoever invents something or adds something to our affairs, that which is not of it, then it is rejected. Okay? And Imam An-Nawawi mentions that, that is in worship, like wudu, ghusl, salah. There's a kayfiyah, there's a way. So therefore, if one adds to that kayfiyah, then it's rejected. Right? But Imam An-Nawawi added, is not only ibadat, because the fiqh is also mu'amalat. So it includes in dealings, it includes in contracts, it includes in capital punishment as well. So here the father saying, my son was employed in this place to this man, and he committed zina with his wife. And I learned and I heard that the punishment for this is this, is stoned, right? And he said, I will pay the ransom. I will give 200 sheep and a slave girl. And the Prophet ﷺ said, the 200 sheep and the slave girl, your ransom basically is rejected. Why? Because there is a hudud muhaddad. There's a specifically prescribed punishment, so there's no way of evading it. Unless it's proven otherwise.
He's married.
He's married. Yeah, that has to be married. Right? So that's that punishment for that. So you see, so even though it sounds good, it sounds like a solution, the Prophet ﷺ said that ransom is rejected. Because there is a sin and there is a prescribed punishment from the Quran for that sin. So this is how the Prophet implemented that. So introducing something, brothers and sisters, to the deen, which, like, based on analysis, I'm not saying like an innovation like before, like there's a difference between ibadah and mu'amalat and adat. Adat is regular customs. Like, for example, some of us are accustomed to sitting eating on a table. Some of us are accustomed to eat on the floor. Some of us, like, for example, back home, maybe used to go to work in a horse, right? Or in a moped, right? Nobody ever said that that's bidah, or the bicycle is bidah, or the tuk-tuk. In Egypt, we call it tuk-tuk. How do we call it in Pakistan? The little, Raksha. Raksha? Raksha. Khalas, teach me, because I used to ride in the villages in Egypt. Yeah, so nobody can say that that's bidah, right? That we have to go in a camel. See, that caught the attention of your niece. She's like, oh, it looks
a,
right?
You have
rickshaw?
Rickshaw.
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 Rickshaw. Rickshaw. Three wheels. Yeah, three wheels, black, yellow.
Yeah. Not only yellow.
But they have different colors. In Egypt, the common color is black and yellow. And they drive through little roads like they own the road, and they put the whole family inside of it. Yeah, mashallah.
Even if you miss the street, that, hey, I
actually, yeah, and there's, and yeah, yeah, subhanAllah. So, yeah, so that's, so those are that, that's, it's okay. The adat is talking about things that are Muhaddad, there are specific like worship and mu'amalat. These are specific. But in regards of, like for example, dress, right? The dress in Pakistan is different than the dress in Bangladesh, different than the dress in America, different than the dress in Indonesia, right? So this is adat. For us, this is an adat that also gives an Islamic identity, but it doesn't make it like you have to dress this way. I dress this way because I enjoy coming to the masjid dressed like this. But when I'm outside, yes, I keep my kufi because it's my alama, my sign that I am Muslim. So when I interact with people, they know this. But I know that the ahkam is different. To say it is obligatory is different, right? So the dress, these are adat. So this you wear now, but there is conditions. What is the shurut? What is the condition? The condition is that the dress has to be loose, right? That's prescribed. The dress has to be decent, right? There's shurut, there's conditions. But the adat is adat, customs. And that's okay. Al-ada muhakkama. Customs are a rule. So long as they do not contradict the Sharia. If a custom, this is a custom, right? To have, let's say, mixed weddings with no, like when there's a lot of ikhtilat, like there's dancing, there's all that. These are adats that are not part of Islam, right? But now if it's a contained environment, right, that's a different story. Right, that's a different story. So the hadith is very simple, inshallah, and I pray that Allah bless us with the ability to understand that. So we should make intention to review our fiqh, our learning, inshallah, and try to implement it even with our children, to learn what is fiqh, what are the conditions, salah, wudu, just reviewing. Like every time, a good thing is, every time Ramadan comes, before review the fiqh of fasting. Before Hajj, review the fiqh of Hajj. So every year you review it. So you improve, and this is ibadat, you improve your ibadat. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Next week we have hadith number 6, which is al halalu bayyin wal haramu bayyin. The halal is clear and the haram is clear. Barakallahu fikum. وصلى الله وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى اله وصحبه اجمعين الحمد لله رب العالمين. Typically I say that we end at 8:45, so salah, it's okay, today is a bonus for you guys. Just quiet.